Right, good morning everybody. It's lovely to see you, and I hope you appreciate how lovely and bright and shiny the whole church is. And did you notice how you could drive your cars in safely today? You didn't fall into a ditch. So thanks to everyone that helped to make it so good yesterday. And we're looking forward to the wedding on Saturday, aren't we? It'll be good. Right, so today you've got me and my hubby, and we're doing the parable of the vineyard, and we're also talking about the cornerstone. So it will be an old age service, and afterwards we have got some refreshments. I think we'll have them in here, although it is quite nice outside. We'll see how the servers feel. This afternoon we've got Moorlands, so Janet and Joan will be pleased if you want to go along and help with Moorlands, and especially with the singing, yeah? Okay, that's at 2:30. Host groups, check with your leaders. Thursday, men's coffee at Cookies, and worship group practice here. And Saturday, I've mentioned Zoe and Noah's wedding at 2 o'clock. Everyone's welcome to the ceremony here, that's at 2. And then as well on Saturday for the, Helen, what's it called? Can't read it. The Summer Family Fun Day. Speak to Helen Tobis if you can go along and volunteer to help with that. It's for the Make Lunch, isn't it?
It's a fundraiser.
Fundraiser for Make, yeah, to Make Lunch. Should be good fun. Then next Saturday we've got Robin coming to talk to us about membership. What about baptism and church membership? And that again is an all-age service. And then can you be considering what you can bring for the open mic the week after? That's August the 13th. And talk to Mike about that. Is that everything on there?
Yeah.
Right, any birthdays?
Barbara,
did you say? Barbara, today!
Yes.
Oh, no, but we're not here. We've got to do it later then. That's the wrong boys arriving then. Okay. Maybe should we wait a bit longer to do other things that men do happy birthday when the boys arrive?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Right. Any other birthdays? I know it's Simon's, but he's not here. Right, so we're going to sing happy birthday a little bit later in the service so that Harry and George are here to sing to make one more. Okay. And over to Meg. Over to
Janet.
Me, it's you, not sure. Lovely, okay.
If the music group would like to join us. I was thinking about what to choose this morning, and I just felt like David, when you read the Psalms, he's so full of praise to God, and his life is not straightforward, as you can tell when you read the Psalms. He always finds time to praise God. So I thought we would have three praisey songs this morning. So we're going to start with Sarah reading Psalm 100, and then will you please stand? Oh, my music's blowing around here. Will you please stand to sing the three songs? And please, if I forget, we're going to take the offering on song three. So over to Sarah.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know the Lord is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Please stand. these are the days of Elijah. I still can't hear you. I'm determined to get you to drown out the music group today. God is on the throne. Let's praise him and sing, "These are the days of Elijah."
Turn yourself off, I can still hear you.
Thank you.
can praise you this morning. No matter what's going on in our lives, in our country, in our world, we know that you are there and that you will never leave us. And this morning, we want to turn our eyes to you, our cornerstone, and praise you this morning for who you are and for what you have done for us in our lives. We pray that you will accept these offerings that we have given you this morning, and we pray that we will continue to worship you during the rest of the service. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
We're going to play a little game with your Bibles. So if you've got a Bible in the pew, in the chair in front of you, can you get hold of it? And quite a long time ago, when we had Girls Brigade and Boys Brigade, we used to play a game called, what did we call it, Carol? Soldier. That's it. So, soldier. You put your Bible in your palm, like a sword. And there's something we used to say, isn't there?
Sword sheath.
Yeah. Sword sheath. And then you take your sword out and you recite what the verse is that you need to find. And then I say fire. And you get that verse as quickly as you can. And then you've got it, you stand up and you read it out. Have I said the right words, Karen? That's Mike.
Sword sheath, sword drawn, charge.
Right, I want you to find Matthew 7:24. Not yet. Matthew 7:24, charge. First one to find it, stand up. David.
Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock.
Thank you. To building his house on the rock. Right, swords in sheath again. So, Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. By dying on the cross for us, he is a safe place. This world can be scary sometimes. Bad things happen for no good reason. And people will hate us just because we love Jesus. But God is our rock. He protects us and he keeps us safe. Right, swords in your sheath again, please. Drawing swords. Acts chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Not yet. Charge. Acts 4, 11 and 12. Becca.
Oh, were you just behind on this?
Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved.
That we can only be saved when we trust in Jesus. He is the cornerstone, the most important stone in the entire building of faith. If the cornerstone is not placed correctly, the whole building would be wonky. Everything we do as we trust in God is built on Jesus, the cornerstone. He is the cornerstone, the most important stone in the entire building of faith. And another verse. Swords in your sheath. Yeah. Draw your swords. Psalm 118, verse 22. Charge. What are we referred to as? Do you know?
saints. So yes, some of us might be referred to as saints. To do with stones, anybody know? Living stones. You are the living stones. And the verse for the living stones, put your swords, chiefly swords again. Draw your sword. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. Charge.
And I promise you I shall be brief. So this is the last of our series in Mark. And those of you who are on the ball will notice that we've jumped a chapter. Last week it was chapter 10, today it's chapter 12. That's because chapter 11 talks about Palm Sunday. But what happened then was Jesus rode into Jerusalem, he went into the temple. Don's reminding me that the children don't need to listen to me. You can go over there and don't have something for you to do. We've got some craft for you. After Jesus entered Jerusalem, he went into the temple, and for the second time, he rearranged things a bit there. And the Pharisees were upset and they said, "What authority do you have to do this?" And he asked them a question. He says, "I'll tell you if you tell me what authority John the Baptist had." And they couldn't answer him. So he said, "Well, I'm not going to give you an answer." But in chapter 12, he does give them an answer. Jesus is just 72 hours away from the cross. He's in the temple still, and he's preaching the gospel to the crowds that have assembled there. And this is what he says in answer to the Pharisees. He tells a story. Verse 1, chapter 12. A man planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a pit for the wine press, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. This would have been a very familiar passage to the priests and the Pharisees. And it's actually based on another story of a vineyard that's found in Isaiah. And there you go. If you read that one, you'll find it's pretty much exactly the same thing. God built a vineyard and he put all those same things in it. The vineyard represents Israel, and the man is God, and the tenants are the religious leaders of the time. In Isaiah, God was looking for good fruit. But did he find? He found only bad fruit. Some translations say good grapes and sour grapes. And he goes on in Isaiah to list six different things that he had against them, that he counted as bad fruit. It's worth looking at it sometimes. There's one of those things that he counts against it, calling the good things that God calls good, bad. And what God calls evil is good. And there are some religious leaders today who are guilty of that. But what did God do to that vineyard? He found it was impossible to get good grapes from them. So he destroyed it. So back to this story. Verses 2 and 3. At harvest time he sent a servant to the tenant to collect from them some fruit from the vineyard. But they seized and beat him up and sent him away empty-handed. The tenants refused to give the owner the fruit. They rejected the servant. And this is a picture of sin. It's refusing to give God what he deserves and rejecting his authority. Israel had failed to produce a harvest of prayer, worship, love, and faithfulness towards God, and justice towards others. And so God sent the prophets to call Israel to repentance. Verses 4 and 5, then he sent another servant to them. They struck this man on the head and treated him shamefully. He sent still another, that one they killed. He sent many others. Some of them they beat, others they killed. These verses illustrate the patience of God and the persistence of sin. For hundreds of years, God has sent his prophets to Israel, but the leaders stubbornly refused to listen. And this is a picture of every human heart too. Our hearts are like God's vineyards. And what are we doing with the life and the blessings that God has given to us? Are we grateful? Are we a blessing to others? That's what Israel was meant to be, a blessing to those around them. Or do we just sit back and say, "Thanks God, I'll take it from here. I don't need you anymore. I want to do it my way, just like those tenants in the parable. We were created to give glory to God, but if we reject them, the longer we go on ignoring his word, the harder our hearts become. Sin tightens its grip on us, and our rejection of God can become even more hostile. But yet God's love still continues his patience towards us. He wants us to come to him, and so he has a plan. Verse 6, he has one left to send, a son. Whom he loved, he sent him master also. They will respect my son. But the tenants said to one another, this is the heir, come, let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard. The owner sending his son into the vineyard is to be understood as God sent Jesus. But Jesus is not just another prophet. He is God's beloved son. And here in these verses, he predicts how the leaders will conspire to kill him. Soon their rejection of God will be complete. With sinful actions, they will reject God's rule. With stubborn hearts, they will refuse God's word. And with selfish pride, they will murder God's son. What will God do next? Let's rejoin the story, verse 9. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. In Matthew 21, verse 43, Jesus adds this. Therefore I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. There are repercussions for rejecting God. Rejection in this parable meant that the wicked tenants are killed and the vineyard is given to new tenants. And as this represents how the leadership of God's people was taken away from the Jewish leaders and given to Jesus and his disciples. We see from this that the plans and the promises of God are permanent. But the organisations, the authorities, the institutions, the systems, even the churches that they come through are all immovable. They're all replaceable. Jesus goes on. Haven't you read this passage of scripture? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it's marvellous in our eyes. As we saw earlier, this is a quote from Psalm 118, which is a messianic psalm about God's chosen king, who will always triumph over his enemies. And so we see the parable switching from agriculture to construction. The leaders are now compared to builders who think some stone is worthless and are ready to throw it and skip. It also shows how the leaders will reject Christ. How they'll have him arrested, give him an unfair trial, and then hand him over to be killed. But that's not the end. See, the cornerstone is the most important part of the building. And through his resurrection, Christ triumphed over his enemies. His resurrection means that he is now the foundation of his church. In Luke 20, Jesus goes on to what is a very severe warning of the judgment that is coming to those who continue to reject him. He says in verse 18, everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom he falls will be crushed. This is the hint of Daniel chapter 2, where the wicked end time kingdom will be crushed by the stone that was cut without hands. It doesn't matter if we drop a glass on a rock, or drop a rock on the glass. As far as the glass is concerned, the result is the same. It doesn't matter how we reject Jesus, or in what ways we oppose him, the result is always the same. Well, we might say, well, what about love and forgiveness? Remember, it was precisely because of Christ's message of love that the religious leaders wanted to kill him. They wanted law, not grace. They wanted to feel superior to others. They wanted to know that they were in and that others were out. They constantly rejected Christ's message and his offer of grace again and again. And so they will receive his judgment. Just listen to how they respond to him in this. Verse 12. Then the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders looked for a way to arrest him, because they knew he had spoken to Pharaoh against them. But they were afraid of the crowd. And so they left him and went away. They chose to reject him and his offer of grace, mercy and forgiveness, and they refused to listen. Now in conclusion, this parable tells us three things. Firstly, about ourselves. By nature, we just like those wicked sinners. Tells us about Jesus. God has made him to be the cornerstone of his church. And it tells us about judgment, that it will come based upon how we respond to Jesus. Just 3 days after Jesus told this parable, he was murdered by the very people who had just heard it. But then 3 days later, after that, he rose victorious from the grave. The stone the builders rejected had now become the cornerstone. So how are we going to respond? Imagine for a moment that our heart is just like that vineyard. Are we going to accept that our vineyard belongs to God? He is looking for our lives to produce good fruit, such as love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That kind of fruit will produce a life of worship, of love, obedience, and service. And there is also a sense of which his church is his vineyard. Are we willing to work hard in this vineyard to produce good fruit for him? Or are we content to let others do the work, just as long as we can share in the produce? Will Jesus be our foundation stone of life? Or will he be a falling stone of destruction? That's what everything comes down to. Either we will fall on Jesus and be broken into conviction, repentance, and salvation, or he will fall upon us. Let's pray. Father, forgive us when we do not produce for you the right kind of fruit. But we are not willing to share the fruit of our lives with you and with others. By the power of your Holy Spirit, will you work in our hearts to produce good fruit, such as love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Make us a blessing to you and to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What should be our response to that? We should be willing to offer our lives to Jesus, as we will sing in our next song. I will offer up this song. Thank you. before we do the blessing, I'd like us to bless Jesus. And we're going to do that by reciting this next verse from Revelation. Let's bless Jesus by saying these words to him.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honour and glory and blessing. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honour and glory and might forever and ever.
Now let's sing the blessing to one another. Remember to look around you.